Good morning. Welcome to Christian Fellowship. You can see we're running a little slack. We're missing a drummer this morning. So you get to be the percussion section here as we get started today. So make sure that you clap long and clap loud unless somebody out there is a drummer and you want to share that gift. All right. I want to read you a passage of scripture this morning because this is why we're here. Psalms 113, praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. What do you think our responsibility here is?
Praise.
It's to praise the Lord, right? Our responsibility. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets. You remember that old song. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. The name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all nations. His glory above the heaven. Who is like our God? Who is like our God? Have you ever just asked that question? Have you ever been someplace where you're kind of out by yourself in nature and said, who is like our God? Do you realize there is none? There is none like our God. Who is like our God? The one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth. We sat the last couple weeks ago and we watched the blood moon, and it was big because it was a super blood moon, but we're sitting there watching it and it looks so big and so amazing, and the Bible says that God has to stoop down to get closer. You gotta stoop down to look at that creation. That's how great our God is. You gotta stoop down to look on the heavens. He rises the poor from the dust, and he lifts the needy from the ash heap. He sits them with princes, with the princes of their people. He settles their barren woman in her home, and as a happy mother of children, praise the name of the Lord. God just does it all. He's got to stoop down to get a look at heaven, and yet the Bible says he raises us up from the dust. Who is like our God? Who is like our God? I think that, amen, he is worthy of our praise, right? I think he's worthy of our praise. I think on a daily basis, we need to ask ourselves, who is like our God? He is worthy of our praise. Let's stand this morning as the worship team comes up, and I just want you to get that in your heart. Who is like our God? You feel like you're standing long enough and you need to sit, you go ahead and sit. That's fine. But God, I just pray that this morning our hearts would come to that place where we say, who is like our God? Who is like our God? There is none like you, O God. There is none. Father, this morning we exalt your name. This morning we realize that if it's not for you, God, we have nothing. You stoop down to see the heavens, and yet you raise us up from the dust. You take the barren woman and settle her in a home, and she's happy as though she's got a house full of children. There is something that comes from a relationship with you. God, I ask that you'd bless this service this morning, that you'd show up. I pray that your name would be praised, that you'd be worshiped this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Bye.
God, we are here to praise you this morning. We just want to continue lifting you up, glorifying your name and who you are. You are a good God. Let's just sing, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. He is good. His mercy endures forever.
Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
are King over all the earth. King over all the earth. Yes, God, we just worship your majesty this morning. We just sing how you are a holy God and how you are the fairest of 10,000. Nothing can compare with your great worth, with your great majesty. Nothing can compare. Not the beauty of the earth. Nothing that we can see, nothing that we can imagine really truly compares with your beauty, God. Thank you for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
brightest morning star. No light can equal your light.
It's right.
Well, good morning. We'd like to receive our morning offering this morning. If we could have our ushers come forward, please. If we could have our ushers come forward. We'd like to receive our offering this morning. I just again want to say thank you so much for giving. You, God continues to bless our congregation. He continues to pour into us, and I pray that God continues to pour back into your life as well. So, Father, I thank you for your goodness towards us. I thank you for your life. God, I ask that as people give, Lord, that you do that. You just continue to pour right back into their lives. And God, that you would reveal yourself even through a simple act of giving. God, that we would recognize who you are and would recognize your presence. And God, as we give, that you would pour back into our lives in ways that are unimaginable. Thank you for your goodness towards us. Bless this offering, I pray now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a couple of announcements. I want you to take a look at the Zumba Fun Fitness and Fellowship. The ladies get together at 6 o'clock on Monday nights. And they're doing some exercise and having a good time together. Also, this Monday night, our missions committee meeting is at 7 o'clock. So if you're part of that missions team, I want to encourage you to be a part. Last week, we started our Helping Without Hurting series. It is a five-week series meeting on Wednesday nights from 6:30 to 8. I want to encourage you, again, it's if you are planning on going on a missions trip with us, that's part of the requirements. But beyond that, I think if you spoke with anybody who was there last week, we're talking about a lot of different things that are going on and how we reach out to people and how we eliminate. Last week we spoke about poverty and the fact that poverty is not just a financial thing. Poverty is something that we really all deal with. We're all broken before God because of sin. And so there's a poverty that reaches each one of us in our broken relationships. So I want to encourage you, that class is still available if you'd like to come out and be part of that on Wednesday nights. It really is a good time. The Haiti 2016 missions trip registration is November 1st. So Kim has all the information for that. Deposit's going to be due of $400 on November 1st. I want to encourage you to, again, if that's something you feel God has put on your heart, please be praying about it. We don't want to go on a missions trip. You don't want to be on a missions trip to Haiti if it's not something God has put in your heart. But if it is something that he's put in your heart, I want to encourage you to come and be a part of that. Also, Kim, if you want to come up, we've got the trunk or treat coming up. We also are doing a fundraiser for our chairs. We'd like to replace our pews. And so you're going to find Jared decided today that he was going to be one of the first to start, and so he emptied his piggy bank. There should be $65 in coins sitting in a bucket back there. So if Jared can give, if you'd like to, I did the quick version here. If you'd like to purchase a chair, sponsor a seat, it's $55 for a couple, $110 for a family of four, $220. If you'd like to sponsor an entire row, $440. Just that easy. So I want to encourage you. We'd like to, before the Christmas season, we'd like to replace our pews and put in some comfortable seats. Again, that just means the preacher gets to preach longer. So we're going to show a video first here. If you'd like to, please play our Trunk or Treat video.
I think that's a promo video we used a couple years back to give you some ideas on what Trunk or Treat is and what it looks like. So it's coming up. It's on a Saturday this year. Yay! So we don't have to rush after work and try to get there to set up. Maybe most of us. So I encourage you to sign up in the back if you want to be a part of Trunk or Treat this year. It's a lot of fun. We get to hang out in the parking lot. We'll have a bonfire, human foosball table, snacks. And don't forget, the trophy's up for grabs once again, so you could be the winner. We have the community vote on the best trunk that they like. So, sign up sheet is out there. Please, if you're thinking about it, if you can commit now, that would be awesome. We really need a number. We need to see how many people we have. There's a lot of effort that goes into planning this and pulling this off, so we need to know if we have enough participation from you all to pull this off this year. So, sign up before you leave today so we can get that count.
It has been a really good thing, I think, for our community. Lots of people have made comments on it. It's a great place for people to be able to come and bring their kids to a safe place. place where it's not all ghoulish and scary, and this has just been a really good thing for us. I want to encourage you as well. On the back table is directory updates, so I want to encourage you to get your information in for updated directory. Sometimes people say, well, you know, my birthday's wrong, or my anniversary's wrong, or my name's not in there. Well, here's the opportunity to get that squared away. So on the back back table is updates for the annual church directory. So we really want to get that in. This morning, I want to continue to talk about enduring hardship. Last week, we talked about enduring hardship as a discipline. We said that hardship really comes to us as not so much as discipline. Sometimes there is that aspect. But hardship as a discipline. When we're going through it, God, what is going on? And this morning, I want to take another, you know what I forgot to do? Wait a minute, I forgot something here. Sorry about that. This week, we had several ladies went to a women's conference, and I was going to ask if any of them had any testimonies they would like to share about being at this conference. So if anybody has any of the ladies, I want to open this up. There was a ladies' conference, and there we go. Thank you, Tracy. Just going to break the ice here. We can all say a little. Look at that.
There was only eight of us that went, but that was kind of, come on, Christy. That was kind of sweet too, because we were just a small group and we could just, part of going to a thing like that, of course the obvious, just getting some set aside, totally focused time with the Lord, which is amazing, but part of that fun is just being together and having time with each other too. So that was sweet. My takeaway, I think, that went kind of throughout the whole everything I heard was all God asks of us is that we be obedient. That's all he asks of us. He's got the rest. He will take care of the rest. He knows how to do what he does. He knows how to be God. And so many times, especially as women, we're like, we have to be in control, we have to have it figured out, we have to have it analyzed, it has to make sense. And that was just the thing that I just wanted to really let that get deep down. And all he asks is that we just be obedient, and he will do the rest.
I think the thing that stuck out to me the most was, we had a speaker, her name was Lisa Turkhurst. And she was telling us about her trips to Israel, which the TT story I'm not telling. She said that she went to the cave that is believed to have been where Jesus was born, and there's a church built on this. And she was telling us about how you would think it would have this grand door, and it's this little door that you literally have to crawl through, and it's called the door of humility. And she really talked about how we need to enter through humility and not pride or anything else. It's all about humility.
I guess the first thing is, it was funny because I told Tracy I wasn't going. I had to get my finances in order at home. I said, I don't plan on going, but if God plans on me going, I'll be there. 2 days before, she had two extra tickets, so me and my friend Christy went. The thing that I got, the biggest thing was, like most humans, I think if I mess up, if I screw up, I have to fix it on my own. And we're not supposed to do that. We have to trust in God. And that's what he wants, is just trust him fully, 100% wholeheartedly.
I don't do this very well. I just want to say I've been learning over the past year. Freedom. And I just want to say that it was reemphasized this weekend how there's freedom in being real. There's freedom in being humble. There's freedom in being able to walk through those doors and not have to pretend you're something you're not. Everybody has their problems. Everybody has their issues. And to not have to come in here and pretend that you have your whole life perfect is so freeing.
Um,
family more than friends. So. I got a lot out of this weekend. I got to meet a lot of wonderful ladies and got to know a lot of wonderful ladies. And even though we may be very different and different lifestyles, we're very similar in so, so many ways. So that was a lot of fun. But I also got a good reminder that I like to take care of people. I like to ignore what's going on in my life and help everybody else in their lives. So I went to this teen breakout, which was kind of funny because I was told first I couldn't go, then I decided to go anyway, so I went. So I'm not a teen, but I relate to teens a little bit. And it was a good reminder that I need to not just put my relationship with God into my ministry, but I need to stop and I need to make time for me to have time for me and my God, rather than just worry about everybody else's. So that one kind of stuck with me a lot, and there's a lot of things, but unless Pastor Tim wants me to preach and do the sermon today, I'm going to stop.
I want to tell you a story this morning. I'm going to start with a story. It's a story of a well-to-do Chicago lawyer. His name was Horatio G. Spafford. Back in 1860, Horatio and his wife Anna lived in Chicago. The Spaffords were friends of D.L. Moody. Anybody ever heard of D.L. Moody? D.L. Moody was a great revivalist preacher. This couple was well known for their support of D.L. Moody. And by 1870, Horatio and his wife had had quite a thriving, booming business, if you will. He was very well to do. But he and his wife suffered a series of tragedies that would change their life forever. And it all began with the death of their four-year-old son. Their four-year-old son died as a result of scarlet fever. Approximately 1 year later, so that was 1871, a huge portion of Spafford's real estate holdings were lost as a result of the Great Chicago Fire. He lost virtually his entire life savings. He invested a huge portion of his money into real estate, and he lost virtually all of that overnight. In 1873, D.L. Moody was planning an evangelistic campaign in Great Britain, and Horatio Spafford and his wife Anna and their four daughters planned on attending these revival meetings in Great Britain with D.L. Moody. They were eager to help. They were eager to serve. They were eager to get away from their own suffering. They were ready. So in 1873, the Spaffords traveled to New York, planning on boarding a French ship, the Ville de Harvey. Before the family sailed, Horatio was called back to Chicago to attend to some last-minute business developments, some things that he had just no way of knowing about. And he didn't want to spoil the trip for his family, so he headed back to Chicago by himself. He sent his wife and his four daughters ahead to Europe, and then he planned to join them later. 9 days later, Spafford's wife, Anna, sent him a telegram from Wales. This is what the telegram read. Quote, "Saved alone," unquote. Can you imagine receiving a text even today from your spouse, from somebody that you know, from your family that says, "Saved alone." And that's it. No other text, no other correspondence, no other way to get hold of her. That's what he received. It turned out that this French ship, the Ville de Harvey, had collided with an English vessel, the Lochearn, on November 22nd, 1873. And it took 12 minutes for the French ship to sink. When she sunk, there were 226 people that died, including his four daughters. His wife Anna reported that her last memories or of her daughter being ripped from her arms by the raging water. She alone had been rescued from the debris. Mr. Spafford boarded the next ship out of New York. During the voyage to Europe, the ship's captain called him to the bridge. And he explained to Horatio that they were passing over the very spot where his daughters had perished. So he returned to his cabin. Now, I don't know about you, but there's an awful lot to wrestle with here. And I'm sure he didn't just get it right from the beginning, but I want to read to you what he wrote, because I think you'll recognize it. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, lest this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate, he has shed his own blood for my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss, that glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but the whole, it is nailed to the cross, I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, O my soul. For me, be it Christ hence to live, if Jordan above me shall roll, no pang shall be mine, for death as in life, thou wilt whisper thy peace to my soul. But Lord, 'tis for thee, for thy coming we wait. The sky, not the grave, is our goal. O trump of angel, O voice of the Lord, blessed hope, blessed rest for my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound and the Lord shall descend, even so. It is well with my soul. Sometimes we think that these hymns were written by people who had great phenomenal lives. This guy had lost his son and had just lost his four daughters. And he went back to his estate room and he penned the song, "It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul." I don't believe that he got it right away. And I can't imagine, when I say he got it right, I'm not talking about the words to that song. I'm talking about getting it right in his heart. He just went through this great tragedy. Can you imagine how many times you would ask God why? 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 Why did I just go through? Why did this happen? How many of us, when we endure trouble, how many of us, when we face trouble, that's the first thing we ask is, God, why? Why did this happen? Why me? I mean, we're in church, so I don't want to sound too much like we would all say, why me? But, you know, we generally start with, why me? I'm sure that, like I said, he wrestled with the pain and he wrestled with the hurt, but he ultimately understood the prize. You see, there is a prize for those that endure suffering. There is a prize for those that endure hardship. Last week, we read out of Hebrews chapter 12, starting in verse 1. The writer of Hebrews says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses," and just previous to this, he was talking about all those saints who had gone before, who never experienced Christ. He was talking about Moses. He was talking about Enoch. He was talking about David. He was talking about Gideon. He was talking about all these men of faith. And he said, we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, by all these people. Let us throw off everything that hinders and sin that so easily entangles us. Let us run with perseverance the race that's marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, who is the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. for the joy set before him, Jesus was the author and the finisher. He's the beginning and end of our faith. And the Bible says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God for the prize that was at the end. He endured the cross. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. When we face trials, when we face tribulation, when we face hardship, that stuff that's in front of us, we immediately want to give up, don't we? Isn't that kind of our human nature? We want to go to the back row, find a couch, curl up, and let the world just keep on going. Okay, maybe you don't. I want to go to the back row. I want to curl up, find a couch, just let it go. We want to curl up, but Jesus endured hardship because of the prize that was at the end. Do you know what that prize is? Is the prize heaven? No. He had heaven before, right? What's the prize? Eternal life. What's the prize? He had eternal life before. But the prize is you and me. The prize is relationship with us, with his creation. The prize is restoration of all of that. Jesus did not need to go to the cross to get eternal life, right? But he needed to go to the cross to get eternal life for you and me. Right? Think about that. Scratch your head a little bit. Ponder that for just a moment. Really, think about it. He endured the cross for us. He redeemed all of humanity. That opportunity is there. And the writer of Hebrews says, consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Ultimately, for any of us to endure hardship of any sort, we need to realize that there is a greater reward. There is a greater purpose at the end. Otherwise, why would we endure it? Wouldn't we want to just get out? There's got to be a greater purpose. In the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy, the Apostle Paul charges Timothy to endure hardship. And as I read this week, I started last week talking about hardship, and I read through this last week, and it just really stuck out to me. Look at verse 5, 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 5. But you, keep your head in all situations. We could stop and just preach right there, right? Oh, Pastor, you don't know all the stuff. He's like, shut up. Okay, maybe not shut up. Stop. Keep your head, man. Keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do you know when Paul wrote this to Timothy? Timothy, they assume at this point, was 21, 22, 23 years old. He was a young man. You know what he was doing? He was pastoring a church. He was pastoring a church. They assume theologians kind of got it figured out. They assume he was pastoring a church of about 3,000 people. And these people came to faith with all their religious background, and they're talking, I mean, goofy stuff, goofy, goofy, goofy stuff. You read about some of the stuff that they did in Corinth, some of the sacrifices they did, they had temple prostitutes. You were a proud father if your daughter became a temple prostitute. I mean, that's what they did previous to Christ. So Timothy is pastoring a church of 3,000 of these goofy religious backgrounded people coming into Christ, and they all want to have their stuff done, and he's facing all the turmoil trying to say, no, we got to get back to what Jesus taught. And Paul finally tells him at some point, keep your head, man, in all these situations. Take it easy. Keep your head. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. That make a little bit more sense all of a sudden? He's telling Timothy, you got this big church. You just keep doing the work of an evangelist. What's the work of an evangelist? What's the work? Share the gospel, right? Share the good news. Just keep doing the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. Okay, so what he's saying is recruit people. Get folks who are able to go out and feed those that are hungry. Get folks who are able to lead worship. Get people, you discharge all those duties. Get somebody to take care of that. You keep your head. You endure the hardships. It's going to come. You endure it. Does it mean that Timothy did anything wrong? Did he do something wrong? Probably. I mean, let's be real. He's pastoring a church of 3,000. He probably made a few mistakes along the way. I know other guys named Timothy that make mistakes. Just saying. He probably made a few mistakes along the way. But that's not necessarily why he was enduring hardship. And then if you go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, starting in verse 11 and 12, here is a trustworthy saying. Paul's saying, look, this is a common saying. You've heard this, man. Here's a trustworthy saying. If we died with him, we'll also live with him. If we endure, we'll also reign with him. He's like, keep your head about you. Understand. If he died and he came back to life, we're going to live with him. If you endure, you're going to rule with him. Paul encourages Timothy to endure hardship. I want to read that whole passage. I'm going to read that in context. I want you to get a hold of that. 2 Timothy chapter 2, starting in verse 1. You then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. This is part of what he's telling Timothy to do. Disciple people. Disciple. He's saying, listen, Timothy, you've heard me teach these things. Grab other men, grab other women who are trustworthy, who are growing up. Teach them these things. And then when they learn them, have them teach them to other people. Disciple them. Spread out the ministry. And then he invites Timothy. He charges Timothy, join with me in suffering like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Now, doesn't that just sound inviting? I want you to pass all these teachings on and then come and join me in suffering like a good soldier. Come on, you can do that with me. Join in. You've seen the sufferings. Timothy knew that Paul had been beaten, stoned, thrown out of the city, left as dead, beaten with rods, chained. He knew all that. Come and join with me. We got a sign-up sheet in the back. Anybody want to go for that? 39 whips with rods. If you want to join up, there's a sign-up sheet for that. Join with me in suffering like a good soldier of Jesus Christ. It just almost doesn't even sound real. No one serving as a soldier, he goes on and he qualifies this. So he says, no one serving as a soldier gets entangled in civilian affairs, but rather tries to please his commanding officer. Similarly, anyone who competes as an athlete does not receive the victor's crown except by competing according to the rules. The hardworking farmer should be first to receive a share of the crops. Reflect on what I'm saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all of this. And I think it's very confusing to us. We want to read those things in very small tidbits. We don't put them together. But Paul says, I want you to join in suffering like a soldier. I want you to compete like an athlete. I want you to work like a farmer. Come on, think about this. Think about this. That's what Paul's telling Timothy. Think about this. There's revelation that's going to come. He said, if you will just process this, if you will think about this, you're going to gain some insights. Reflect on what I'm saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all of this. Remember, Jesus Christ raised from the dead, descended from David. That this is my gospel, he says, for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal, but God's word is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake. Why does he endure everything? For the sake of the elect, that they too may obtain salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Do you, I want you to leave that up there for a second. Therefore, start at therefore. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect. Now, you and I would think, well, the elect must be people who are followers of Christ. They're elect. They're somebody who's really special. But he goes on to say that they too may obtain salvation that is in Christ. Do you get that? Paul says, I want you to endure the struggles and the hardship because there are people out there who need to see and to hear the gospel. He doesn't say, I want you to endure hardship for the church. You got this great thing called the church. You got this great body. Endure hardship for them. That's not what he says. Endure for the elect because they need to hear the gospel of salvation. They need to hear the good news. Folks, we're called to endure. We're called to endure not for the church, not for our own life. We're called to endure for the sake of the gospel. We're called to endure as evangelists. You're saying, well, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I didn't make it up. Why did Jesus endure the cross? For the what? For the glory that was on the other side, right? He endured the cross for the glory that was to come, right? We're to endure hardship for the elect that they may obtain salvation. I want to run in the back row. I want to sit in my office and curl up on the couch when I face hardship. I don't want to face hardship head on. Bill Hybels said in a conference one time, I do leadership a little bit different. This is not how I do leadership. This is how I need to do leadership, but I don't do it this way. He said, if I smell something kind of funky, I want to run towards it. I want to go figure it out. Let's figure out what's going on. Most of us, when we smell something funky, we want to run the other way. I don't want to deal with that. That might be hardship. Paul says that we need to endure hardship for the sake of those that still need salvation. That's maybe a different look, folks. Here's a trustworthy saying. If we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we disown him, he's going to disown us. If we're faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot disown himself. Keep reminding God's people of these things. Warn them before God about quarreling about words. It is of no value and it only ruins those who listen. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, but who correctly handles the word of truth. Paul instructs, he challenges, he invites Timothy through these three analogies to endure hardship. He said, like a good soldier, like an athlete, and like a farmer. When we choose to follow Christ, we enlist in this thing that's called God's army. When we accept Christ, we're actually on God's side. That's kind of dodgy, right? I'm on what I say is right because I'm on God's side. I don't mean that. But we're in God's army. As Christian soldiers, there's hardship that is going to come our way. Expect it, count on it, plan it, get accustomed to it, bear it, know what's happening, get a proper perspective on hardship. It's going to come, all right? Anybody who says, you know, you become a Christian, everything's going to be easy, they're just lying. That's just all there is to it. They're lying. It's not easy. Plan on it. We're called soldiers. But here's the deal about a soldier. Once they join, it's anybody. You talk to a soldier. When they join the military, they cannot get wound up with their own cares and worries. I have an acquaintance. When he signed up to the military, he got sent to Okinawa. Just before he went in the military, he decided that he should get married because he and his gal had been dating. So they got married, and he went to Okinawa. And when she found out he was in Okinawa, she went to Okinawa. And his commanding officer called him in and said, "You send that woman back to the United States. If the U.S. military wants you to have a wife, we will assign one to you." Guess what? She had to go home. It was back in the... You're all sitting there like, I'm not sure I like that. You join the military, your purpose changes. You're in a new place. That's the way it is. When you joined this thing called the church, when you chose to follow Christ, whether you like it, whether you know it, whether you didn't know it, your purpose has changed. Your purpose has changed. You signed on the dotted line, and you get to start by going through boot camp. Guess what? That's going to look like hardship. Barry, you went through boot camp. Yeah, a lot of fun? No. He didn't even say that with a smile on his face. Your purpose has changed. A soldier does not have time for his own concerns. There's a lot of controversy. Probably 4 or 5 years ago, you remember the soldier whose name was Bo Bergdahl? Anybody remember Bo Bergdahl? Bo Bergdahl was being traded for 5 Islamic terrorist generals. He was taken into captivity. His fellow soldiers were outraged. Do you remember why they were outraged? They were outraged because Mr. Bergdahl deserted them during a time of military action. He fled the scene. We'd call that AWOL. And he got captured. And now, several years ago, the U.S. government ended up trading him. The Islamic terrorist group is saying, look, if you want your dude back, that's fine. We'll give you your soldier back, but we want 5 U.S. generals. And so our military is going, yeah, we got to figure out a way to do this. And his buddies, his guys that he served with, are like, leave him there. He abandoned us. Say, that's pretty harsh stuff. You should look up what 2 Timothy chapter 4:9 says. Paul says to Timothy, do your best to come to me quickly. Demas, because he loved this world, he has deserted me. I need you to come because this guy bailed on me. We're encouraged to follow Christ as soldiers, good soldiers. Follow Christ through difficulty, through struggle, through hardship. Don't leave your post. Don't leave your post. You leave your post, other people suffer. We walk away, we're leaving somebody else exposed. Soldier's life is not easy. The apostle commands us, endure hardship. The next analogy is the striving of an athlete. I've never been much of an athlete, but I get competitive. Not so much in sports, but get a deck of cards in front of me in a game of May I, and I'm telling you, I'm playing to win. So it is. Similarly, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not receive a victor's crown unless he competes according to the rules. One of the things that's promised here is a victor's crown. He says, "Look, you're gonna push through." My brother-in-law ran grandma's marathon several times. And so one time I took my sister-in-law down there and we're standing at it's a 26.2-mile marathon. I think we were at Lemon Drop Hill, which is right around 18 miles, and some lady's standing there with a bell saying, "Welcome to Duluth! Welcome to Duluth!" And all I could think of is, you're lying! They got 18 more miles to go! And my brother-in-law tells that when you're in grandma's marathon and you're running the last 0.2 mile, you have to run past the finish line. Finish line's right here. You're coming downhill. You have to go past and turn around and come back and make that corner. And when he was making his last push, 26.2 miles, I'm standing on a corner. There's how many thousands of runners. I'm standing on the corner, and he's from me to Lauren away. He's running. And I'm like, hey, how's it going? Congratulations! He didn't see me. He didn't even, not only did he not acknowledge me, afterwards I'm like, man, I was right there. Didn't you see me? He's like, where? He was focused on the prize. His ride home meant nothing. His brother-in-law really meant nothing. He was focused 26.2 miles, and he had about 75 steps to go. The last thing he cared about was who's standing there cheering for him or not cheering for him. Now let's talk about these guys. They finished the race. Do you realize what most of them do immediately after the race? They start pounding down all kinds of fluids, and half of them end up over in a medic's tent. Their feet are beaten, bruised. Some of them pass out along the way. We couldn't find him for a half an hour. He just ran by me. He ran from here probably to the street out there. And by the time we got from here to there, he was gone. Couldn't find him anyplace. He was in a medic's tent. But you know what? He won the band. He won the award. He won the crown. He won what he was running for. Paul says it's the same for us as believers. As believers, there's something for us to be running for. There is a reward at the end of it, and it's not a medal. It's a victor's crown. Beyond that, you know what it is? It's the elect that need still to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's why we do this. Farmers, the next analogy is farmers. We probably only really have one. We have a few gardeners in here, but we probably only have one real farmer in the mix. And guess what? You put all that money, all that effort, all that energy into the ground, and then 3 months later, you do what? Hope. Hope. Yeah, maybe you harvest. If you don't get hail, and if you don't get wind, and if you had enough sunlight, and if you had enough rain, and if you had enough prayer, and if you had enough time and energy and people and manpower and blah, 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 blah. And then when you get all done harvesting, you hope that there's still value at the end of it. You hope that the numbers, the prices are up here instead of down here. Paul's saying, look, lay it on the table, man. Lay it on the table. Put it out there. Put it out there. What, for what purpose? Why do we endure hardship? Why do we endure hardship? For the elect. For those that need to hear the gospel. I have tons of analogies, all kinds of things I could share with you. The long and the short of it is, Paul says, reflect on what I'm saying and ask the Lord to give you insight. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they too may obtain salvation that is in Jesus Christ with eternal glory. Paul says, we endure for that reason. Keep doing the work of the evangelist. Keep pouring it out. Keep hanging in there. Keep keeping on. Endure for the sake. There are people. I will tell you one story, and I believe I've told you this before. I guess he'd be my first cousin. He's 20 years older than I am, probably. As a kid, I didn't really know him. When I accepted Christ, he was very instrumental in me accepting Christ. He and his wife had 3 boys. When I was a teenager, 17, 18 years old, his son had just turned 16. And one winter day, we were up, my buddy and I, we were up with cleaning the roof of a house, chiseling off a bunch of ice and snow and stuff that was backed up. And my buddy's dad came out and got us. He said, "Guys, we got to go to the hospital." He said, "Steve's been in an accident." He said, it's bad. That's all he said, it's bad. So we got to the hospital, and we didn't know how bad. But my cousin's son was killed in a snowmobile accident. He was on an old dirt road. That's where they lived, was on this old dirt road where there was maybe two cars a day that went down this road. And Steve had just gotten his snowmobile fired up, and he was running across the yard, and he found a snowbank at the edge of the road, and he jumped his snowmobile over the road, is what he was doing. And he got hit by a truck doing about 50 miles an hour, broadsided him. He was 16 years old. He was a drummer. He was a football player. He was a basketball player. He was an absolute comic. When this guy walked into the room, I mean, people were just busted. He was just a lovable kid. When they set up to do the funeral, they set it up to do the funeral at the largest funeral home in Hibbing. It probably held, 400 people or so in their main area, a couple hundred maybe in their main area, and then out in the foyer. And we went back to the church, and we got extra sound system, and we set it up. And when I got, I was involved in all of that. I had to go and get the extra sound system. When I came back, it was mid-January, cold, literally 25, 30 below zero cold. And there were people that were, the funeral home was full, and it went all the way down the city block this way, and the line went clear down the city block that way. I mean, 1,000 kids. That's hardship. That's tough. You know what his mom and dad did? If this was the casket and this was the line of people, his mom and dad walked every person by that casket. Every person. Talked to him about every picture that was there. Talked to them about all the things that they were involved in, listened to these kids and their struggles with what they were facing, and then they went back and they got the next one. And they walked every person. Mom took one guy, dad would take the next, mom would take the next, dad would take the next. And I asked them about it later, how did you do that? How did you do that? And both of them said unequivocally, it's just by the grace of God. It is just by the grace of God. But they understood. They understood. They understood that their hardship was an open door to the gospel for each person that they took through the line. That's what they got out of it. That's what they walked away with. I had a chance to present the good news. He's dead. He's not here anymore. He's up there. He's alive. There's an eternal glory to it. Folks, we usually endure pretty little before we walk away. Doesn't take us long to just throw in a towel and say, you know what, I've had enough. But God wants us to endure. There's going to come a time when we are going to face hardship in our life. And he says, endure it for the gospel. Endure it for the gospel. Endure it for the good news. Endure it like a soldier. Endure it like an athlete. Endure it like a farmer. There is good news that is available at the end. There is good. There's a prize on the other side that's far greater than what you can even begin to imagine. Amen? Are we ready to do that? Are we ready? For the glory? Are we ready for the prize? Are we ready to endure? Because I'm telling you, that's what we're called to do. We're not called to throw in the towel when things get tough. Right? This morning we're going to have our elders, our ushers come forward. We're going to do communion. I want to read a passage of scripture to you. It's a passage that we read often. If you guys would like to come forward and hand out the elements, please. First Corinthians chapter 11 is pretty common passage of scripture. Go ahead and just hand out the bread first and then come back and hand out the juice. Paul, the same Paul that encourages Timothy to endure, the same Paul that encourages Timothy to be a soldier, the same Paul that wrote most of the New Testament, said this. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Jesus endured the pain. He endured the beating for the promise that was ahead. And he's telling Paul to tell the church, "Do this in remembrance of me. I did this. I paid this price willingly. I did it for the glory which is to be seen. So do this in remembrance of me. Whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine himself before they eat the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. That's why many among you are weak and are sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But he said, if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we'd not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we're judged in this way by the Lord, we're being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world." Here's where that word discipline takes on a different meaning. This isn't a discipline of our soul, a discipline of our physical body. He's saying there is a discipline, there's a spanking that's going to come. There are results, there are consequences if we take communion with the wrong heart, with the wrong attitude. If you're walking in unforgiveness, if you're harboring unforgiveness, if you've got some junk hanging around in your soul, say, "You know what? Yeah, God's convicted me. I got this sin thing going on, but I'm okay with that. God's not okay with that. He wants us to repent. You're a soldier. And if you're a soldier, then you're not about your business. There's a different purpose." Don't take communion if you've got junk floating around in your soul that you've not dealt with. If God's convicting you of something and you're not willing to deal with it, I'm going to encourage you this morning. Leave the bread, leave the juice. Don't take it. Because the Bible says that you're eating sickness, you're eating judgment on yourself. It actually goes on to say that there are some who've died because of this. The bread that you have is representation of the body of Christ. Your sins, my sins, they deserve punishment. They deserve punishment. And Jesus took that punishment for us. If we continue to sin without any regard for that, it's like spitting in his face. The Bible says it's like crucifying him again. Matter of fact, Scripture tells us that there's really no place to go. If we refuse his forgiveness for our sin, there's no other place to go. You got to carry that sin because there's no other place you're going to get forgiven for it. If we choose to sin and spit in his face, And there is no other place for forgiveness for us. His blood was the blood of the new covenant. He paid the price in his blood for our peace, for our hope, for our salvation. He paid that in his blood. I want to take just a couple of seconds, 30 seconds, 45 seconds. I want you to do business with God. If you've got something in your heart that you've held against somebody, if there's a judgment, if there's something you've got going on, you need to get it right. You need to get it right. There's nothing else that can be said. If we don't do that, then there's no other place for us to get forgiveness. I'm going to be quiet and I'm just going to let God speak to your heart. You maybe need to set down the bread and the juice. You maybe need to forgive. You maybe need to say, you know, I got to call somebody. I got to talk to somebody. I got to get up across the aisle. Let's just take a few minutes. Father, we thank you for the bread. We thank you that this body represents not just a piece of bread, but it represents your body. Represents the fact that you were beaten, bruised, wounded. You took on our sin so that we could be in a right relationship with you. You paid the penalty of my sin. You paid the penalty of each one of us. God, you paid the penalty of our sin. And that was taken in your body. Father, we recognize that. We say thank you so much, God, for doing what we could not do. We ask, God, that you would help us, keep us clean, speak to our heart so that we don't hold anything against anybody. You've paid our entire bill. Let's eat the bread together. Father, this juice represents, according to your word, a new and everlasting covenant, a covenant that has no end, a covenant that was sealed in your blood. You paid the price. And that covenant tells us that we have redemption, that we have hope, that we have life, that we have one who's paid the price for our sin, and that there's no going back on that, God. We have one who's, you're not going to remove or take that covenant away from us. It was so vital that you actually fulfilled it for us. You did our part in it, God. And then you sealed it with your blood. So God, today we drink this juice with that in mind, God. It's the blood of the new covenant, a new and an everlasting covenant in Christ Jesus. Let's drink together. Thank you, God, for your goodness towards us. Thank you for your life. I ask you, God, to just bless each person who's here today. In Jesus' name, amen. Some of you may have glass. No glass cups. All right. Bless you. Have a good afternoon. There is a chair in the back there. As you leave, that chair represents the chairs that we're looking to replace here in our sanctuary. So if you didn't give a chance to give, there's an opportunity, and we're going to talk about it one more time after this. So bless you. Have a great afternoon.
Thanks for joining us for today's broadcast. You're also invited to join us in person Sunday mornings at 10:30 a.m. Viewers like you help to make this program possible. If you'd like to help, send your tax-deductible contributions to the address on your screen or give online at cfcdl.org. Thank you. If you enjoy this program, we'd love to hear from you. Comments can be sent to us online or write to us at the address on your screen. Thanks again for joining us. See you next week.